I played Richard III.
Five curtain calls.
There were five curtain calls. I was an actor once.
I think I gave Matthew an idea.
No, I'm serious. I smell gas.
Who wants s'mores?
No, wait! Boo! Hello, everybody, and happy Snoboween. Go ahead. That was Bill Skarsgård, buddy.
We really do live in a society, eh, Murray?
Are you finished?
Yes, I'm done.
Good.
For now.
As you can probably guess, I was going to review The Crow. But you see, because someone blew up my room, I had to spend all of October recreating it, down to the last details. So that means I didn't get the script written in time. But you know what's really funny? I also didn't release my Galaxy Quest review. So, for Snoboween this year, you're getting my Galaxy Quest review. I'm sorry it wasn't The Crow, but you know, it's better to have a video than to have no video. Happy Snoboween, everybody. Hello. And welcome to the 100 subscriber special.
We really have 100 subscribers?
By the time this video comes out, over 100, actually. Why are you wearing those bunny ears?
Well, I was going to wear them for Easter, but since someone didn't finish their Prince of Egypt review, I decided to wear them now.
All right. Now, I'm sure you're wondering what film...
It's in the title of the video.
Oh, right. Today we're reviewing Galaxy Quest.
Galaxy Quest is one of those films I saw growing up where I'm not entirely sure how I was introduced to it. My best bet is that my mother shared it with me, and that's how I saw it. While I liked it as a kid, I started loving it as an adult. Part of that is because I had become more familiar with the Star Trek franchise. But one of the reasons I liked the film even as a kid was because of Tim Allen. I knew him as Buzz Lightyear from the Toy Story films, and as Scott Calvin slash Santa from the Santa Claus trilogy. This review has been requested by friends and family alike, so I figured it was the perfect film to review to celebrate reaching 100 subscribers.
Red scarf, black shoes. Wait.
We open at a fan convention for the TV show Galaxy Quest, where we see the cast of the show meet with their fans. The cast are largely not excited, except for the show's lead, Jason Nesmith. Jason loves and thrives in the attention of the fans, more than his fellow castmates. But when he overhears some strangers talking about how pathetic he is, it hurts him so much that he later snaps at a fan. After the convention, he goes home and drinks himself to sleep. The next day, he's awakened by a strange group of people he met at the convention, who have arrived at his house to pick him up for an event. After a quick limo ride, Jason arrives at the event. As it turns out, the group are actually from a race of aliens called the Thermians, and the event is a real conflict with Ceres, enemy of the Thermians. Jason, still unaware that it's real, attacks Ceres' ship and seems to win. When Jason is sent home, he sees the awesomeness of space, and realizes that he is helping real aliens. After arriving home, he goes to find his fellow castmates to tell them the whole ordeal. After a brief run-in with Brandon, the fan he yelled at the day before, he reaches his castmates as they're signing autographs. When he tries to convince them that he went to space, he uses the communicator the Thermians gave him. The same kind of communicator that the rest of the cast have. Uh-oh. But it turns out, his communicator was swapped during the earlier run-in. Jason is then informed that Saris is alive. When he tries to get his castmates to join, they initially refuse. But after some convincing words from Fred...
I think we should have just taken the gig. I mean, who knows the next time he'll ask us.
They decide that they want to board the ship. This includes actor Guy Fleegman, who had a guest appearance on an episode of the Galaxy Quest show. This is when they experience space travel for the first time, confirming that Jason was telling the truth. Considering the circumstances, they take things with... most of them take it well.
That was a hell of a thing.
Good one, Fred. This is where they meet the Thermians, and we learn that the Thermians base their whole society off the historical documents.
I'll buy the penis and popcorn.
Get in the bag.
Me, why don't you get in the bag?
Let the party begin!
Though most of Jason's fellow castmates are apprehensive, especially Gwen and Alexander, they do join. But things take a turn when they learn about what happened to the previous commander. Things get worse when they encounter Saris. After getting bombarded by incoming fire from Saris, the crew barely escape with their lives. Worst of all, the ship has been damaged. This includes the beryllium sphere, the ship's main power source. With the beryllium sphere irreparably damaged, they'll need a new one. Question is, will they get the sphere? Will Guy fulfill the red shirt prophecy? And never give up, never what?
Never give up! Never surrender!
And miss out on all of this. Come on, you guys want to do that, anybody?
One of the most obvious positives is the Galaxy Quest crew. That's because every one of them brings their A-game. Tim Allen, Sigourney Weaver, Alan Rickman, Tony Shalhoub, and Daryl Mitchell are all excellent, both in their performances and their chemistry as a group. They all handle the drama and comedy well.
I grab the toast.
Next.
Had I moved an inch to the left, the beast would have killed me. On the other hand, my crew is in danger.
Go faster, Tommy!
I'm going as fast as I can, Jason!
Well, I've pressed turbo. I've always said press the turbo, right?
Oh, it's right here! Right here!
Well, press it and hold it down!
The enemy is matching velocity.
Enemy is matching velocity!
We're at it the first time!
Gosh, I'm doing it. I'm repeating the darn computer.
Listen, they're telling me the generators won't take it.
We've got to stop!
We're stopping, we die. Tommy, just hold that thing down.
Yeah, hold the turbo down. It's for quick boosts.
Oh, like you know.
The same goes for the Thermians. They are all great in their roles as well. Like the Galaxy Quest crew, each Thermian brings their A-game. Everything from the way they move to the way they speak works so well.
Doesn't she talk?
Her translator is broken.
Okie dokie.
Would you like to don your uniform?
No, you know what? I'd like to skip that. I got this gig in Van Nuys in about a quarter of an hour. Is that all right?
As you wish.
Crewman number Guy.
Guy. Okay. Our goals, our values had become scattered, but since the transmission, we have muddled every aspect of our society from your example, and it has saved us.
We're getting you out right now. It's perfectly safe, isn't it, Tim?
It has never been successfully tested.
What did he say?
Hold, please.
I heard some squealing or something.
Oh, no, everything's fine.
But the animal is inside out.
It turned inside out?
And it exploded.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time to introduce a new segment on the show! This segment will only show up when I review a film with Sam Rockwell in it, like this film. So, Sam Rockwell is amazing in this film as Guy Fleegman. He's an amazing comic relief character that perfectly personifies fear.
I'm not even supposed to be here. I'm just crewman number 6. I'm expendable. I'm the guy in the episode who dies to prove the situation is serious.
There's a red, thingy moving toward the green thingy.
What?
Red thingy moving toward the green thingy. I think we're the green thingy.
They are so cute.
Sure, they're cute now. In a second, they're gonna get mean, and they're gonna get ugly somehow, and there's gonna be a million more of them.
Hi. Hi there, the girl.
Did you guys ever watch the show?
Same goes for Justin Long as Brandon. He does a great job playing a massive fan without going too over the top.
I understand completely that it's just a TV show.
Dude, oh, hold on.
I know there's no...
Wait a minute. Stop for a second. Stop. Conveyor, wait.
No ship.
It's all real.
Oh my god, I knew it!
I'm sure this may seem obvious, but the comedy in this film is great. Part of that is down to it feeling like a love letter to both Star Trek and its fans. But for me, it's the fact that the comedy doesn't feel forced. It's able to coexist with the film's more emotional moments. And it also feels like it comes from the characters themselves and not from the screenwriters.
At ease.
It's like throwing gasoline on a flame. What?
I'm just jealous about being on the show, man.
I remember that sound. That's a bad sound.
Wait. Could you possibly try not to hit every single one?
Sorry, man, they're drifting towards us! I think they're magnetic!
Alex, where are you going?
To see if there's a pub.
Could they be the miners?
Oh, sure. I mean, they're like 3 years old.
Miners, not miners.
Speaking of characters, I love the design of the film's villains. Particularly the main villain, Saris. It mainly comes down to how convincingly real they all look. They don't look like people in suits. They look like actual living beings. The last thing I would like to praise is the music done by David Newman. Why does that name sound familiar?
Son of a bitch!
Can't escape that cat!
But David Newman's score was one of the things I liked in The Cat in the Hat, and I love it in Galaxy Quest. The music in this film feels like it would fit right in with an actual Star Trek film. It does all of this while not feeling like a mockery of the music in Star Trek.
New source of beryllium must be secured.
We need another one.
You broke the ship. You broke the bloody ship!
This is usually the part where I give you my negatives, but honestly, I just can't find anything. And even if there was anything, it certainly wasn't anything worth complaining about. Well, there is one thing. But it's really not suited for the negatives. It's more suited for...
Well, screw that!
Okay, if you couldn't tell from the previous clip, Gwen didn't originally say, "Screw that." In fact, there were a few lines that were censored to ensure the film got a PG rating.
You are so full of it, man!
You think you could do better, Laredo?
Right with that Laredo stuff.
And you know, while I would love to hear the uncensored audio one day, I honestly think the censored audio works. Especially...
Well, screw that!
It's part of the So Bad It's Good dub club. A club whose members include the TV ads of Scarface and the Big Lebowski.
Why don't you try sticking your head up your toilet?
See what happens when you find a stranger in the Alps? That's what happens! You see what happens, Larry?
Something I find interesting is the fact that despite the film's popularity, there was never a sequel. There was a TV sequel in the works in the mid-2010s, which was cancelled due to the untimely death of Alan Rickman. And while I wish he was under less tragic circumstances, I'm okay with the fact that there is no sequel. Sometimes a film does not need a sequel, though I'm sure I would have watched it if it had been made. Here's something I find fun, and it's the fact that Alexander never takes off his headpiece in the film. Sure, it gets bowel damaged in the finale, but it never fully comes off. I like that little detail. It's like Alexander can never fully escape the character of Dr. Lazarus. Though it can be said that he probably did take it off, just not in the film itself. Here's another thing I'd like to talk about. If you've seen the film, you know the scene where Jason is using the bathroom and he overhears some people making fun of him? Well, I've heard that this is something that happened to William Shatner. It's a very believable moment. Here's something I'd like to talk about quickly. The film's aspect ratio has been... an interesting topic. When the film was released theatrically, The film starts in a 4:3 aspect ratio when showing off the Galaxy Quest TV show. When they transition to the convention, it opens up to a 1.85:1 aspect ratio. And then when Jason sees space for the first time, the frame opens up fully to a 2.39:1 aspect ratio. However, on most current home video releases, the film opens in 4:3, but then transitions to 2.39:1 for the rest of the film. Well, I can't say that it ruins the film, because honestly, it doesn't. I still would love to see a version of the film that is fully accurate to the original theatrical screening. I would also like to point out that Rainn Wilson is in this film. He plays one of the Thermians. His screen time may be short, but his presence is enjoyable. Also, Corbin Blue is in this film. He plays the young Tommy. It's a very small appearance, but I find it neat that he's part of the film.
Oh my god.
This is one of those films where I can't think of any negatives. But there are certainly a lot of positives. From the main cast and the Thermians to both Sam Rockwell and Justin Long's performances, the comedy is also great, the designs of the villains are spectacular, and the music really ties it all together. Check this film out.
Thank you all for watching. I'll see you next time.
Do you even have a clue what you're going to be reviewing next time?
No, I don't. Is that gasoline I smell?
I think I gave Matthew an idea.
No, I'm serious. I smell gas.
Who wants s'mores?
No way!
Thank you.